Hi folks, this is Jay. Hope you're okay. Today we're looking at excuse me, an overview of the story of the Old Testament, sorry. And we've looked at two parts of the history, and now we're looking at the conquest of Canaan right up to King Saul, from about 1422 BC to 1065 BC. All right, that's where we come into the story now. So we have the people of God who have been led out of Egypt. They're struggling around the desert, walking around, and then God decides to lead them out of the desert into Canaan, to the promised land. They're led by the leader Joshua, and we start at Joshua 6 is a good place to start. It says, "Now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have given Jericho into your hands, its king and the mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priest and shall blow the trumpets. And it shall come to pass, when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city shall fall flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him." Excuse me. "Then Joshua the son of Nun called the priests and said to them, 'Take up the ark of the covenant, and let 7 priests blow 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord.' He said to the people, 'Proceed and march around the city, and let him who is armed advance before the ark of the Lord.' So it was, when Joshua had spoken to the people, that the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord advanced and blew the trumpets. The ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed of men went before the priests who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard came after the ark, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. Now Joshua had commanded the people, saying, 'You shall not shout or make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I say to you, shout. Then you shall shout.' So he had the ark of the Lord circle the city, going round it once, and then they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priest took up the ark of the Lord. Then 7 priests bearing 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord went on continually and blew with the trumpets, and the armed men went before them. But the rear guard came after the ark of the Lord while the priest continued blowing the trumpets. The 2nd day they marched around the city once and returned to the camp. So they did 6 days. But it came to pass on the 7th day that they rose early about the dawning of the day and marched round the city 7 times in the same manner. And on that day only they marched around the city 7 times. The 7th time it happened, when the priest blew the trumpets, that Joshua said to the people, 'Shout, for the Lord has given the city. Now the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that went in, that we sent. And you by all means abstain from the accursed things, lest you become a curse when you take off the accursed things, and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels and bronze are consecrated to the Lord, they shall come into the treasury of the Lord.' So the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpets, and it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat, and the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city." So there we see that this battle at Jericho of this city, but the book of Joshua goes through a lot of battles with different kings, showing how God's people took and conquered the Canaan land. And then by the time you get to Judges 13, I just checked the time, by the time you get into Judges 13, Israel have become a world power. So if you look at Judges chapter 13, You have the judges like Samson in this chapter, in this book, the Book of Judges. Amazing book. Society had gone all corrupt, and God had raised these kind of leaders, saviors of Israel. It says in Judges chapter 12, Judges chapter 13, sorry. Just checking, yeah, Judges 13. Again, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. There was a certain man from Zorah in the family of Danites whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Indeed, now you are barren and have borne no children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Now therefore, please careful not to drink wine or similar drink, and not to eat anything unclean. For behold, you shall conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head. For the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of Egypt." Now, that's the story of Samson. You know Samson, the strong man? Samson and Delilah, and he had his hair cut, and he had his eyes plucked out. Well, do you remember, just go back a minute, do you remember when they were going into Jericho? Just a little backtrack, it's important. When they went into Jericho and take Jericho, God said, don't kill Rahab. Now Rahab, I'll just go back to that passage. Go back to Joshua 6 a minute. It's just important, really. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, okay? Now, what's happening in the Old Testament are prophecies of the Messiah. Rahab was going to be the great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmother of Jesus Christ. That's way back in Joshua. It's time. Okay? Anyway, in the book of Judges, what you get is God's people have settled in the land of Canaan. They've taken areas. They haven't conquered all of Canaan, but they've settled. And they've not gone into battle to take the whole of Canaan. And they've settled for about 400 years. They just did everything in their own eyes. And God had to raise up judges like Samson. So that's that period. We got the Canaan, we got the conquest of Canaan in Joshua's time, then this book of Judges time where men did what they wanted in their own eyes. Then we have in Judges 1 Samuel 9, in the end of the Judges period, is the prophet Samuel was born. This is very, very important because Samuel was used by God to consecrate King Saul and make Israel into like a proper kingdom compared to the other nations. So if you turn to 1 Samuel chapter 9, well, we go to 1 Samuel chapter 3, I'm just checking time. He says, "Now the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days, and it came to pass at that time, while Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow so dim that he could not see before the Lamb of God, he went out into the tabernacle of the Lord where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord God called Samuel and answered and said, 'Here I am.' So he ran and to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you called me.' And he said, 'I do not call you, lie down again.' And he went and lay down. And then the Lord God called yet again Samuel. So Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you called me.' And he answered, 'I did not call you, my son, lie down again.' Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. And the Lord called Samuel again a third time. So he arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you did not call me.' And then Eli perceived that the Lord had called the boy. So that's a wonderful picture there of God calling the boy Samuel. That was a significant time in the Israel's history. Like I said, from Canaan to the reign of Saul, we're just getting on the precipice of Saul. King Saul was from 1422 to 165 BC. And the prophet Samuel was called as a boy to raise up and consecrate a king. The people of Israel were sick and tired of these different leaders in the Israel in Israel at that time. So they wanted a king, and they didn't want God to rule them. They wanted man to rule them. So they said, give us a king. So the prophet Samuel went to God, and God said, give them a king if they want a king. And King Saul was consecrated. Checking the time. So this is a seminal time. As they were going, this is 1 Samuel 9 verse 27. As they were going down to the outskirts of the city, Samuel said to Saul, tell the servant to go on ahead of us. And he went on, but you stand here a while that I may announce to you the word of God. And so Samuel consecrated Saul, King Saul, as king. Verse 10, chapter 10, 1 Samuel 10. Then Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said, it is not because the Lord has anointed you commander over his inheritance. When you have departed from me today, you will find two men by Rachel's tomb in the territory of Benjamin at Zelah, that they will say to you, the donkeys which you went to look for have been found, and now your father has ceased caring about the donkeys, and is worried about you, saying, what shall I do, my son? Then you shall go on forward from there and come to Tabor, tree of Tabor, and the three men going up to God at Bethel will meet you. And it just goes on about his consecration. So we see the boy Samuel called. Well, first of all, Joshua should have, and his people should have taken the land of Canaan, but they rested and they got in trouble. You know, you've got to take the land for God. You've got to go and do mission, folks, and take the land and not rest. You rest, and you do the Bathsheba twist. You do sins like David did. Do you remember? He rested in the battle when he should have been fighting, and he ended up committing adultery. And then secondly, when we rest and the world goes to pot, and men do things in their own eyes, but God always has his people like Samson, and he raises his people up through leaders and preachers. And remember that. And then thirdly, Samson was a boy, and he was called by God three times. Now, there are people here today who have been called by God. Three times at least God has said to you, preach the word. I've called you to preach. I've called you to preach, and you ain't preaching. Now get preaching. And then finally, King Saul. King Saul was made king over Israel because the people of Israel were moaning against God and wanted to be ruled by man. So God gave them a king. And if you keep moaning against God and you keep moaning and saying, God, I, you're not doing this for me, you're not doing that for me, he might just give you what you want. And if you get what you want, it might not be good for you. Okay? So be careful. Don't moan against God. Alright, so we've seen this period of history. And we'll move on to the life of David in the next part. Thank you for listening. God bless you.